have the extended Meese family here this morning, too. Yes, Becky.
And I have my brother's and your wife's daughter from Mary.
Welcome. Okay, who's excited for school to start tomorrow? Not so much. Well, you have to go anyways. That's the bad news. Okay, tonight is our monthly firmly grounded praise service. Potluck dinner starts at 5:30, and the praise service follows at 6 o'clock. If weather cooperates, tonight's service will be outside, so please bring a lawn chair with you and a dish to share for the potluck. Again, that's at 5:30 and 6 tonight. Next Sunday, September 4th, the youth group will be going to the Canfield Fair to see the Newsboys perform. Youth will meet at the church at 4:30 and will depart from here. Cost is $20 plus money for fair food. Today is the last day to sign up for this event, so if you'd like to do that, please sign up in the Narthex after service today. Yes. Okay, that's open to anyone, not just the youth group, if you're interested. Looking ahead 2 weeks, mark your calendars for two events on Sunday, September 11th. HUM will be holding a mission fair after church and will be promoting many of the missions supported by HUM and some new ones that are getting started. And then at 4 o'clock that afternoon, our church will be hosting a rally for Africa University, which is a private university founded in 1992 by United Methodist Church worldwide. James Sally, who's the Associate Vice Chancellor, will be sharing about all the wonderful things happening at Africa University and its partnership with United Methodist Church. So again, that's two Sundays from today on September 11th. Now we have a special announcement from Hunter Montgomery regarding his Eagle Scout project. Is Hunter in here?
Good morning. My name is Hunter Montgomery. I'm from Troop 122, and we have scout meetings here on Monday nights. And I'm currently here because I'm working on my Eagle project. And my project is installing carbon monoxide detectors in your homes. And I've been working with Pastor Matt, Tim Kavanaugh, fellow scouts, and my scout leaders. And prior to the service, hopefully you were given a brochure on all about carbon monoxide, and that's also part of my project too. As a part of my project, if you have a financial need, I would like to provide you a carbon monoxide detector, which I have a table set up in the back, and I will need like information, your first name, your address, phone number, and what type of house you need. That way I know how many carbon monoxide detectors, so I can call you so that I can get the detectors to you, hopefully soon once I have them. And I hope to protect as many homes as I can. So thank you for your time today.
Good morning. Just a couple quick announcements. First of all, if you are on the education committee, we have a meeting today after church. It shouldn't be super long. And if you are teaching in September or shepherding, we have that meeting at 4:30 today. So lots of meetings today. And then I really, really want to thank all of you who came out to help with the playground. We got it done in record time. We had 20 people sign up, parents and church members. I think we had like 30 or 35 people actually come, maybe more, which was wonderful. We got it done in an hour and 45 minutes. So I want to thank you so much. It looks fabulous. The mulch is being delivered this week, so by next weekend it will be here. The kids come the 7th. Super excited. And I want to thank Kristen Gephardt. I don't know where she is today, but please, if you get a chance, thank her. She made us wonderful lunches. So thank you again for all your support of the preschool. What a blessing you are to the preschool, and what a wonderful mission. Thank you.
Okay, last announcement. Several of our Howland band members will be selling Tiger discount cards after church today. So never mind. We'll announce that next week. Any other announcements this morning? Okay, flowers on the altar this morning are given by Debbie Messino in loving memory of her mom, Betty Goring. Flowers are also given by Bill and Lanny Meese in celebration of their granddaughter, Jocelyn Ann Meese's baptism today, and by Wayne and Char Stifler in celebration of their anniversary. Congratulations to you guys. Let's take time to greet one another.
Friends, I'm going to invite you to remain standing, please, as you return to your places this morning. Please remain standing as you return to your places. As we begin our time of worship this morning, we just begin with an opening song of praise, Hosanna, as we sing praise to God this morning. Let's join together and lift our voices. Please pray with me. Lord God, we sing Hosanna. We sing praise to you today for the wondrous God that you are. We give you praise for all the blessings you give to us, for the freedom we have to gather in this place to say thank you today to worship you for the wondrous God that you are. Fill this place and each one of us with your spirit as we worship you today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We have one of the great joys of being a pastor today, and that is performing baptisms. And unfortunately, the Lord God made me not intelligent, but bald and good-looking. So I never remember to have Debbie put the words up on the screen. So you're going to have to get out those books here this morning, the hymnals that are found down there in front of your pew, and share with a neighbor or something this morning. And I'll invite the Meese family to come forward. And congregation, you'll turn with me. You'll have to flip around a few times in your hymnal. It begins on page 39 in the hymnal. Page 39, if you'd like to follow along with the liturgy today. So once more, we're on page 39 in your hymnal. You can share with your neighbor, and we'll have to flip around a few times. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you both now, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please answer, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, please answer, I do. And will you nurture Jocelyn in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, please answer, I will. I ask you both as godparents, will you assist them in fulfillment of these vows in raising Jocelyn in the Christian faith? If so, please answer, I will. Congregation, you have vows as well. So I would ask you, if you would please, to turn in your hymnal now to page 44. We slip ahead a few pages to page 54. There's a vow that we take it as an entire church family that we will support them in the vows they're making today as well. So on page 44, do you as a congregation accept the responsibility of assisting these parents in fulfillment of the baptismal vows? And do you undertake to provide facilities and opportunities for Christian nurture and fellowship? Members of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care Jocelyn, whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that this child may grow in the knowledge and love of God through our Savior Jesus Christ? Congregation, I ask you to turn one more time in your hymnal with me, please. One more time to page 41. Page 41. We're going to be blessing the water at this time together. I think many of you know that I was able to bring back water from my trip to Israel that we're using to baptize children now in this church from the Jordan River. So I'm very excited about that. We'll bless this water now. And if you would help me do that, please. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and Jocelyn as she receives it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. Amen. Amen. You may close your hymnals. What full name is given this child? Jocelyn Ann Meese. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May God confirm the covenant that has been made for you this day with your parents, your godparents, and this family, this congregation of family and friends, that you may be blessed and know God throughout your life. Amen. And now one of the great joys is getting the shower off to everybody, so we're going to pray Jocelyn around a little bit here so everybody can say hi. Hi. Hi, everybody over here. Hi, everybody. You have fist bump tricks, okay. Fist bump. Hi, everybody. Hi, everybody. Hi, everybody. Hi, I'm the newest member of the family of God. Hi. I'll show you off over here still too. Hi. Hi, everybody. Hi. Hi, everybody. We'll give you back to proud mom and dad here. She was an angel. All right. And won't you join me in walking her into the family of God? Be seated. Congratulations. And we're thankful to have Justin with us this morning. As you know, our choir doesn't perform in the summertime. We have special music, and Justin's going to provide that for us today. Thank you. Justin, that was wonderful. How old are you? 14. Justin, that was wonderful. Great job. Clay, you did okay too. You were okay too. So if you're a little bit younger than Justin, all the kids, I'd like you to invite, come and join me at this time for the children's time, please. Okay, you gotta be more enthusiastic than the adults when you say good morning. You ready? Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord today. Now, I said to everyone you were sitting out there, I'd like to invite the kids to come forward. I think we can put that word up here for you. See, we had it there. Invite. Invite. See that? Who could tell me what that means? What does the word invite mean? I saw your hand first. Tell me, Will. You can invite them to a party, right? What would be another example of something you could invite somebody to? To ask them to go someplace with you. Exactly. That's what it means to invite. Tell me, Henry. Oh, Henry, you are reading my mind. Henry said you can invite someone to church. That's exactly right. You know what? School starts, most of you are in Howland schools, I think, most of you anyways, right? We start school tomorrow. Maybe some of you in other schools and you start sooner. You already started, but it's back to school time. So for the next few weeks, I'm taking the adults back to school. You know that? They're going back to school. And we're going to talk about... I know for some of you it already started, I know. We're talking about the mission of the church, and the first part of that is to invite. There's three parts of it. The first part is invite, and just like Henry said, one of the places we can invite people is to church. Now, why would you invite someone to go to a birthday party? Why would you want to invite someone to come to a birthday party? Tell me why. Because they'd be your friend, right? And would you like to have them there if they were your friend? You would, right? Because they're your friend, okay? Why might you invite someone to come to church? Right, so they can learn about God, right? And if someone was your friend, wouldn't you want them to know about God, that God loves them? I would. And so that's why we try to invite people to come, because if we love them, we want them to know that God loves them, right? I don't want you to go door to door and knock on people's doors and say, hey, you want to come to my church? I don't expect anybody to do that. But people that we know, right? You could say, hey, you want to come to my church? We have lots of kids there, lots of things that go on. Tonight, there is a great concert. How many of you ever heard, we hear Firm and Grounded every Sunday morning. How many of you ever heard one of the concerts they do on Sunday nights? Guys, you guys would all love it. And the kids get up and dance and stuff. There's always a number we get up and dance to and stuff. There's lots of good food and everything. We're going to be outside tonight. It's fun. And we're worshiping God. So you can invite people to like that. Of course, we do lots of things for kids here. Vacation Bible School and all the work we put in Sunday school and stuff on Sunday mornings. There's a lot that goes on, a lot to invite people to, okay? But one of the main things God wants us to do is invite people. Invite people. They took the word down, but you know what I mean. Invite people, okay? To invite people to know about him, because God wants everybody to know about him. And that happens when we invite people to come. Great things that happen at church. Okay? Now, sometimes people invite people in different ways, okay? I had a good friend who had a birthday party last night, and I didn't find out about it until the day before when my wife said, did you know we were invited to this party? And I said, no. And said, well, it was on social media, but, you know, I'm hardly ever on Facebook or social media, right? So I didn't know, right? So sometimes there are invitations, but you don't find out about them sometimes, right? Because no one actually says to you. Sometimes you actually have to say to somebody, because some people are dense like me. Right? They don't pay attention to all the different things. Sometimes you actually got to say to somebody, hey, why don't you come to my party, right? Or something like that. You got to actually invite them to come. And you know what? We could put on social media all the time or stuff. Hey, we have a website and everything. Come visit our church. It's a great place. But you know how people really come? It's when we say, hey, why don't you come out to something at my church that's going on? Why don't you come out to this thing that the kids are doing, right? When we do that, people are much more likely to come. But it takes a little courage, right, to invite someone to come. It doesn't take courage to invite people to a birthday party, right? But it shouldn't really take courage to invite people to church, but sometimes we've got to be brave and do that and say, hey, why don't you come visit? It's a great place for kids. All right? That's the first thing that God wants us to do. There's three things we're going to talk about in the next 3 weeks. This first one is to invite people. All right, let's say a little prayer together, everybody. Dear God, we invite people to things all the time. We invite people to birthday parties, and we invite people to anniversary parties and all kinds of celebrations that we do. Help us to remember that we need to celebrate you, too, and all the great things you do for us and your love, and you want us to invite people to know you and your love. So help us to be boys and girls who will grow up always inviting people to know about you and your love. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, everybody. You go back to Children's Church.
Bring our prayers to God with our joys and our concerns. If you have a joy or concern you wish to share this morning, please raise your hand and an usher will bring you a microphone. Please continue to keep Sid Case in your prayers. Sid's recovering from his surgery at the rehab unit at Lake Vista. Sid thanks everyone for their prayers and asks for continued prayers as he recovers. Karen France asks for prayers for her friend Karen Hanshaw, who was recently diagnosed with brain cancer and is undergoing testing for that.
I have a praise. Thank you all for praying for my husband. His heart cath went well. He's free of any new blockages, and his stents were open. And he was safe after having the catheter break in his arteries. They were able to get it out without damage. So I praise the Lord.
Thank you, sir.
Today is our 51st anniversary. Today, exactly today. Thank you. Last year, Clay and Carolyn had a special concert for us at the Lemon Tree. So we're going to come and listen tonight. So it'll be a little different, but we'll enjoy it. So thanks for the clap.
Congratulations.
Okay, we have a joy too. It's my wife and I. We're celebrating our 52nd wedding anniversary this Tuesday.
Over the years, we have prayed for my grandnephew who lives in France. His name is Jacob, or you would call it Jacob. He has a very rare form of cancer that does not respond to chemotherapy or radiation. So they are in the process of searching for specialist surgeons to remove a malignant growth on his trachea. So it'll be the next few weeks while they're meeting with surgeons. But please keep Jacob and his family in your prayers.
After about a year of being in and out of the hospital, Pam Miggs is home recuperating. She's still very weak and not able to walk. Debbie set up a meal calendar on mealtrain.com, so please sign up on the website or see Debbie Messino if you can help. And please keep Tammy Penman in your prayers as she underwent gallbladder surgery on Friday. Says she's home resting and healing, so please pray for a quick recovery for Tammy.
I have a joy. Our daughter Emily had her scan on Friday, and there's no cancer anywhere else in her body. She is having her treatment now. She's in isolation till Monday afternoon, and she's doing well. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so as Doug mentioned, my mom is home after a year. She still has a very long road ahead of her, but we are happy to say that she is here visiting with all you today because she missed you all so much.
It's great to have you back, Pam. Carol Klentz asked for prayers for her daughter, Cheryl, who's dealing with complications from a recent surgery. And also, I just ask for prayers for all our young people heading back to school this week and in the coming weeks, whether it's down the hallway at the preschool or heading off to college. Prayers for our youth and our church. Prayers for earthquake victims as well this week. Continued prayers. Any other joys or concerns to share? Okay, seeing none, we'll sing with Firmly Grounded, Here I Am, Lord.
I'm
with me for a moment of silent prayer as we come to our God together in prayer today. Lord God, we gather here together this morning to sing Hosanna to you, to begin by singing praise to you, by offering up our thanksgiving, just by our very presence here, saying we appreciate so much your blessings to us, and we come to gather here to say thanks, to worship you for the God that you are. That's why we've come, Lord. But we've come also to say, Lord, that we will hold your people in our heart. People who know you, who are part of this church family, people who we've mentioned this morning who are going through hard times, and people outside the walls of this building or outside this family, Lord, they are your people. To say that we will hold them in our hearts. And we know that one of the ways we do that, Lord, is by inviting them to know you and your great love. So we pray, Lord, that you would help us to say, here I am, when it comes to the mission of your church, when it comes to inviting people to know you and your love. We pray that we would answer that call, that we would say, here I am, that we'd not be afraid to simply invite people to know you and your love. May we do that because we love them enough that we want them to know your love. Father, we pause to hold in our hearts this morning your people who we've mentioned this morning, who are in need of the touch of your healing hand. We pray for Sid, for Karen, for Jacob, for Tammy, for Pam, and we celebrate that she's back with us today. Ask you to continue to heal her. For Cheryl. We pray, Lord, for everyone starting back to school, the students and the teachers, that you'd be with them and all the administrators as well. We pray for the victims of these earthquakes, Lord. We pray you'd be with them in their time of need and all who are helping. And Lord, we just give you thanks that Emily's scan has come back well, Lord, and we just pray you continue to be with her and heal her. We celebrate with people in our church family like Bob and Bonnie and Wayne and Sharv and married over 50 years. We celebrate so many blessings you've given to all of us that we have to celebrate. We hold all of your people in our heart this morning, Lord, inside this church family. And we pray that we would hold all your people in our hearts, that we would say, here I am, Lord. So bless and heal each of these people that we've mentioned today, and bless us when we go out into this world. We thank you for this time that we have to gather together here in this sanctuary, a safe place from the problems of the world outside and all the burdens that we carry. But when we leave this place and go out into the world and we see other people struggling with their burdens, may we remember we have so many opportunities and ways to invite them to know your love, that they don't have to carry those burdens alone, that they could be part of this family as well. Give us the courage and the calling to do so. And we pray these things together this morning in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We worship God at this time with the offering of our hearts and treasures. Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear God, we recognize that we are able to worship here because of the generous giving of this congregation. Yet our giving and our prayer extend beyond us. We pray that these offerings and tithes will be used to reach out to others in our community and around the world who need your love and grace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was going to skip the next hymn in the interest of time, but actually this song only takes 2 minutes, and it was one of my favorite songs when I was a kid, and it fits the theme really well. So I'm going to ask you to sing along. We might run a few minutes over this morning, but it's Pass It On. Please join together. All right, Clay and Brandon, I'm going to see how good you are. I'm going to change the benediction response to the first verse and chorus of Pass It On at the end, okay? Let's cue it up at the end. Guys, make that switch for me. I'm going to go through the scripture this morning as we preach. So I'm going to invite you, if you would, take a moment to pray with me and for me. Oh, Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We're going to be looking at Jonah this morning. The book of Jonah is just 4 chapters long. You can read it in 6 or 7 minutes sometime if you don't know all the details of the story. Everybody knows he gets swallowed by the big fish. If you don't know all the story, we're going to look at a big part of it this morning and how it applies to our theme today as we go back to school the next 3 weeks to invite, inspire, involve. We're going to look at the first few verses together of Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down the Joppa where he found a ship bound for that port, meaning the port of Tarshish. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Now, you've probably heard this part of the story before. You know that Jonah was asked to go preach. You know that he's running away. But we don't maybe realize Jonah was asked to do something impossible. We don't understand it today in Jonah's context. I'm going to try to explain it to you. Now, everyone is asked, right, to tell people about God. We're all at the Great Commission. The last thing Jesus said before he ascended to the Father is, go to all people everywhere, baptize them in my name. I think it's on the front of your bulletin this morning. The Great Commission is what he gave us all. That's what Jonah's given, a message to go tell people about him. But he ran away. Why? Well, Nineveh was the capital city of the Assyrian Empire. It was possibly the largest city in the world at the time. It was certainly one of the largest cities in the world. And Jonah's reasons for not wanting to go there, his big reason was simply he didn't like those people. He didn't like the Assyrians. The Assyrians were a ruthless nation bent on world conquest and had long been a threat to Israel. Jonah didn't want those people to be saved. He wanted them to be destroyed. They were the enemy. He didn't want them to receive God's mercy. But worse than that, if he went there, Jonah might have been killed. They were the enemy. They were the oppressors of his people. At worst, he might have been attacked and killed. At best, he thought he would be mocked and treated like a fool. So Jonah didn't want to go. So I can try to give you like a modern context. It would be kind of like God saying to a Jew who lived in America during World War II, hey, I want you to go to Nazi Germany, and I want you to tell all those people there, Hitler and everybody else, to stop killing Jewish people and turn back to God. Can you imagine how someone, a Jew in America, would have received a message tonight from God? Of course, he would have been afraid. It would be like me telling you, hey, God wants you to go overseas to a terrorist organization like ISIS and take your Bible and preach to them and tell them to drop all that stuff they're doing and come to Jesus Christ. Would you want to run and go do that if I said, I think God is telling you to do this? Of course not. Of course not. That's what Jonah was being asked to do, to give you a modern context. So we see in this map, can help you see how Jonah reacted, what he did. So Jonah's hometown was where letter A is there, Gath Hepher. That's where Jonah was from. And he was being sent to Nineveh, to letter B over there in Assyria, the capital of the Assyrian Empire. And what he decided to do was to get as far away as he possibly could. So you see where letter A is, there's a boat there by Joppa. The Bible says he went to Joppa so he could get on a boat that was bound for Tarshish. And you can see that Tarshish is on the southern tip of what we call Spain today. Now for Jonah, this would have been as far away as he could possibly go. This would have been considered the ends of the earth. So he was trying to get as far away as he possibly could. He had no desire to go where God was sending him. In fact, he was going to go the opposite way for where Jonah would have been considered the ends of the earth. As far away as he possibly could. Tarshish was maybe 2,500 miles or so away. That's how far away he was going. It was the most remote destination he could find. But Jonah should have known these words, these verses from Psalm 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, which is what Jonah was trying to do, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. There's nowhere we can go to run away, to escape the presence of God. Maybe some of us are trying to run away today sometimes, trying to run and hide from God somehow. But wherever we go, God is there. And we can't hide. God is always with us. What happens to Jonah? Let's pick it back up at verse 4 again where we left off. The Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, how can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us and we will not perish. Now we usually think of Jesus as calming the waters, right? You know the story where Jesus calmed the storms. And we talk sometimes in sermons about how when there are storms in our life that God sees us through, calms those storms for us. But here, God is stirring the waters up. Why? Because God is desperately trying to get Jonah to come back to God. But the ship and the sailors were all in a dangerous place. Jonah's disobedience had put other innocent people in danger. Our sin can affect the lives of innocent people sometimes. I can't tell you how many times I've seen people over the years addicted to some type of drug or alcohol, and it absolutely affects and sometimes destroys their entire families, innocent people whom they love. And other times I've seen the selfish actions of a parent hurt their kids. Our actions can hurt other people. But God doesn't want that to happen. He doesn't want to destroy the boat. The sailors are trying to throw things overboard to lighten the load. And then they find Jonah asleep. They ask him, "How can you be asleep? Get up and call on your God." You may have heard me say before that when we see a ship or a boat in Scripture, it's often a symbol for the church today, a metaphor for what it means to us today, what it has to say to us. So when we look at Jonah, we're to think about how we are like Jonah. So I say to you that sometimes we're like Jonah, asleep in the boat. What do I mean? Well, God asked him to do the impossible. What he was being asked to do, it's impossible. So he runs away. And when God tries to get his attention and turn him back to God again, he just tries to go to sleep and ignore the storm that God is sending. Friends, that's us today sometimes. God has given us a mission of inviting others to know God and his love. And when we don't accept that mission, sometimes, you know what, we just run away. We just kind of lower our heads. We may not set sail someplace, right? But we're like, well, someone else is going to invite people to come to church. I can't really do that. And sometimes when God tries to get our attention, you know, and call us back, and we're turning a deaf ear, and God is saying to us again, you know what, there's someone you really should be inviting to know the love of God, because that's part of why the church exists. You know what, we'd rather just kind of sleep through that message. Kind of just rather sleep through that and not pay attention to what God says. Even when God is trying to sometimes desperately get our attention, we sleep right through it. So what happens to Jonah? Going on to verse 7. Well, then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots." This is what they did, you know, to figure out who this was happening to. Who's responsible for this calamity? They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us? What did you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What has your running done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, "Well, what should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" Jonah says, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." So Jonah knows he's the reason. The sailors, they know it's Jonah too. They don't understand exactly what's going on, and they worship all their own gods, and Jonah's worshiping the one true God, and the storm is there, and the sailors are obviously afraid, and what are they supposed to do? Jonah says, "Throw me in overboard." Well, the sailors don't want to do that. This God is already angry at them. They don't want to throw his prophet, his person, overboard into the water. So I ask you, why doesn't Jonah just jump in? Why tell the sailors to throw him overboard? If that will calm the water down, why doesn't Jonah just jump in? He knows that they don't want to hurt Jonah. I believe it's because God was going to wrestle with the hearts of the men who are on the ship. Let's look at this part together again. Beginning with verse 13 again, please. Verse 13. Instead, the men did their best to row back to land. They don't want to throw him overboard, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried to the Lord. They're crying out now to Jonah's God, to the Lord. "O Lord, please do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man. For you, O Lord, have done as you pleased." Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, And the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. They were forced to cry out to Jonah's God. That wouldn't have happened if Jonah had just jumped in. The men were trying as hard as they could to row the boat back to shore. So they ended up making vows to God. These men were people who worshiped all kinds of false gods, who knew nothing of the one true God. And Jonah has really made a mess of things here. Jonah has really made a mess of things, and yet these men come to know God. Even though Jonah has screwed up as much as he possibly could and disobeyed God as much as he possibly could, somehow these men have come to know God. It's a reminder that God can take our imperfect testimony. God can use our mistakes. God can use our failures, even our sins, to bring glory to him. So when you wonder if you can invite someone to church sometime, when you think you won't know what to say, when you think you will fail somehow, remember that God uses even our imperfect testimony to bring people to him. Verse 17, this is the part of the story that everybody knows, right? But the Lord provided a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was inside the fish 3 days and three nights. That ends chapter 1. And we're not going to read chapter 2 together, but in chapter 2, Jonah is inside the fish, and he's thankful to God for using the fish to save him, because he's out to sea, so that he doesn't drown, and he repents. And the fish comes, and the fish spits Jonah out onto dry land. So you see, the big fish story is that God saves Jonah from the sea, forgives Jonah, and gives Jonah another chance. So now look with me, beginning with chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very important city. A visit required 3 days. On the first day, Jonah started into the city. He proclaimed, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. Remember that part here in a minute. The Ninevites believed God. They declared a fast, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. Then he issued a proclamation in Nineveh, "Be the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let any man or beast, herd or flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish." When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction he had threatened. His message was 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. So I ask you now, how many more days is it to the presidential election? Is it more than 40? Like 70 or so, right? 70 days until America is overturned. Wouldn't it be great if the kind of revival that happened in Nineveh would happen here in America? When Jonah does what God asks of him, when Jonah does what God asks of him, when he invites people to change their ways to know God, God does a miraculous thing. But it's God who changes their hearts. God changed in this story the hearts of some of the roughest characters around, and Jonah didn't do that part. God did. All Jonah had to do was the impossible. You thought I was going to say all Jonah had to do was invite people. But no, Jonah had to do the impossible. Jonah had to go to the enemy. He had to go to Nazi Germany like that. He had to go, you know, to ISIS like that. That's the place Jonah was asked to go to, where he had to fear for his life, and it is no wonder the man ran away. If God asked you to go to the enemy, to take your Bible, to go to a stronghold of ISIS across the sea and preach to them a message of repentance, I think, like Jonah, you would run away as fast as you possibly could. And if I asked you to do that, if I did, I think you would mock me and find another church to go to, right? But here's the thing. God is not asking you to do the impossible. God is not asking you to do that, and neither am I. The Great Commission is to go to all people everywhere and baptize them, but the mission of our church here is simply to invite. The first part of it is simply to invite. It's not impossible. We just need to invite people. And remember that God even uses our mistakes and our failures when we try. The problem is, although God has given us a mission to try, to just invite people, most of us run away as far as possible. And when God tries to get our attention again, to remind us again, hey, we should invite people to know his love. Maybe, I don't know, like in a sermon this morning, we hear it again and remind ourselves. You know what we'd rather do? We'd rather fall asleep like Jonah. Just fall asleep, kind of turn a deaf ear to that, and sleep through whatever kind of wake-up call God tries to give us. I told you this morning, one of the great joys of ministry is baptizing a young child. This morning, Bill and Jen had little Jocelyn baptized. What a tremendous joy and blessing that is. Why did they do it? Because they love Jocelyn. Because like all the other parents, you see all the kids that we have up here every Sunday, because like all those parents who are bringing their kids to church here every week, they want Jocelyn to grow up to be a person of faith who loves God and knows that she is loved by God. Why? Because they love her too. And if they really love her, they will honor those vows and keep bringing her. And if you really love her and them, you will honor your vows and continue to encourage them, fulfill your vows. We hold God's people in our heart as we sung together. We hold them in our hearts. And it should be exactly the same with the people outside these walls if it is with those inside these walls. We should love everyone like they love Jocelyn. God is asking you to love people enough outside these walls, love them enough to invite them to know him and his love. It may be people who are part of this church family whom you haven't seen in a while. It might be a person at work or at school or from your neighborhood. God isn't asking you to go over to Nineveh. God isn't asking you to go to ISIS. God is asking you to say to someone you know, hey, there's a really great band playing at my church tonight. Want to bring a lawn chair in here? Free meal, too. There are so many ways we can just invite people. All Jonah did was give the message. God did the rest. Our job is just to give the message and invite people to come. But we can't run away and we can't fall asleep because God has given us a mission. You heard me jokingly say earlier, wouldn't it be great if a revival in America would happen like it did in Nineveh? You know when that will happen? It's when the church remembers its mission, when we invite people once more to come back to Christ, when we don't run away or fall asleep, but live that mission out. When Jonah finally did that, hearts were changed, lives were changed, and that is not a big fish story, if you will. It's true. And so I pray that it would be true for us today. We just need to invite people. God will do the rest. But we can't run away. We can't fall asleep. We have to love people enough to want them to know the love of God. Amen. Please stand if you are able for our closing hymn. We have a story to tell to the nations.
Thank you.
save us. Type of revival I was talking about when Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, a kingdom of love and light. You know that would happen? It's when we invite all people to know God and when we truly live out the mission. So I invite you to love people enough to invite them to know the love of God, to invite them to be part of our church family. There's so many things we do here, so many different ways to invite people. Find some way. Don't give up. Don't fall asleep. Don't run away. Invite them to know the love of God. One of my favorite songs when I was a kid, we're going to close with in a second, Pass It On. I love the part of once you've experienced it, you want to pass it on. So may that be what happens to us when we leave this place today and always. And as you do so, may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, His Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you forevermore. Amen.